Take a second to look at the two graphs that we've got pictured here. We can see in this first example that these two graphs are quite a bit different from each other. For instance, we just look at kind of this nice smooth curve of the one function, and obviously it's got a gap or break here for an asymptote. The other curve is smooth, it continues on throughout that entire domain that we're looking at here, but we've kind of got this more jagged, curvy shape to it. So we've got two graphs that are obviously quite different from each other. But in our second image here, if we take that same graph, initially we were looking at that from x equals negative 4 to 4. Now we've expanded that view to be from negative 20 to 20. We still see this initial range where these two graphs are quite a bit different from each other. But as our x value increases to positive infinity, these graphs become, if not completely identical, almost identical to each other. And the same thing happens as x approaches negative infinity. So even though for some values of x closer to 0, these two graphs have quite a bit of differences from each other, for these extreme values of x, as it gets very large, very small, the two graphs are the same. The reason for that is that as x approaches either positive or negative infinity, so it gets to those extreme values, the behavior of a function is always going to be controlled by its leading term. So essentially, there's one term in a function that just increases, decreases, whatever it does, changes so much faster than the rest of the function. So in our example here, example 3, identify the leading term for this function, and then find the limit as x goes to both infinity and negative infinity. So the leading term is always going to be the term with the highest power. So in this case, negative 7x to the 7th is our leading term. So if we want to take the limit as x goes to infinity of our function p of x, we really only have to consider what's happening with this leading term, because it's going to change so much faster than those other two. So we can just take the limit of negative 7x to the 7th as x goes to infinity. So to get an idea of what this value is going to approach, you want to just try plugging larger and larger values in for x. So for instance, we'd be taking negative 7 times 1 to the 7th would give us negative 7. Negative 7 times 10 to the 7th would give us a larger negative number, or so I guess we could say a smaller number. Negative 7 times 100 to the 7th, we'd be getting a smaller, smaller, smaller number. So basically we want to think about what would the value of this function be if we plugged in some really, really, really large number. And in this case, what we would see is as we plug in those larger and larger negative numbers, as we plug in those larger and larger numbers, our function is getting increasingly negative. So our function value is getting smaller and smaller, so it's headed to negative infinity. If we consider the limit as x goes to negative infinity of negative 7 x to the 7th, well, now we're plugging in smaller and smaller values, so negative numbers that are just getting smaller and smaller and smaller, raising that to the 7th power, so that's going to remain negative, multiplying it by negative 7, so our negative times a negative is going to end up being a positive infinity. So we just have to consider that dominant term and just think about what's happening to our function value as we plug in some really, really large positive number in this case, or here, plugging in some really, really, really small negative number. So here we plugged in 10 million, here we could plug in negative 10 million. So similarly, in example 4, we want to determine the end behavior of this given function. So again, we can just look at our leading terms in both the numerator and denominator, and take the limit as x goes to infinity of 7x to the 7th over 5x to the 8th. So here, x to the 7th is going to cancel with 7 of the x's in the denominator, leaving us with the limit as x approaches infinity of 7 over 5x. And again, we want to think about what's going to happen as we put in larger and larger values for x here. So we get 7 divided by 5, 7 divided by 25, 7 divided by 10,000, 7 divided by 10 million. So what's going to happen is we keep putting larger numbers in the denominator, this value is going to keep getting closer and closer to zero. If we consider the limit as x approaches negative infinity of 7 over 5x, we again want to plug in larger and larger numbers for x. And actually, in this case, we're going to end up approaching that same value of 0, where it's going to be approaching it from the negative side or from the left-hand side. So that limit's still going to be headed to 0. So since we take the limit as x goes to infinity and negative infinity, and we get real numbers as a result, we have horizontal asymptotes at y equals 0 on both ends of this function. In example 5, again, we look at the leading term in both the numerator and denominator. So we take the limit as x goes to infinity of 3x over 5x. Our x's are going to cancel out, leaving us with the limit as x goes to infinity of 3/5, which will be 3/5, since it's just the limit of a constant. The limit as x approaches negative infinity of 3/5 will also be 3/5, since it's just the limit of a constant again. So we have horizontal asymptotes at y equals 3/5 on, again, both ends of the function, as x goes to both negative and positive infinity. In our last example for this portion, again, looking at our dominant terms only, because these are going to change so much faster than the 2x squared and the 3x. If we take the limit as x goes to infinity of 42x squared, or 42x to the 6th, over 15x to the 5th, x to the 5th will cancel with 5 of the x's in the numerator, leaving us with the limit as x goes to infinity of 42x over 15. So plugging in larger and larger numbers, this function is just going to take on larger and larger values, meaning that's going to head off to positive infinity. If we take the limit as x approaches negative infinity of 42x over 15, now we're plugging in negative 10, negative 10,000, negative 10 million, negative 10 billion. So in this case, we're going to have a negative times a positive is going to lead us to negative infinity as that limit. So since at neither end do we get a real number, we get positive or negative infinity, that means we have no horizontal asymptotes at either end of this function. The end behavior of the function is headed off to positive infinity and dropping down to negative infinity. So one thing to note is that if we take the limit as x goes to either of the infinities, and we get either positive or negative infinity, technically that means the limit does not exist. So for a limit to exist, we have to get a real number as the limit. So getting infinity or negative infinity means the limit does not exist. But we still make the statement that it equals infinity equals negative infinity to give us a little bit more information about the behavior of the function at those extreme values.